when three insurance companies tell people that that's exactly what this is and that they can't cover their through their insurance, that's exactly what this is. It is a factory defect, and it's happening on new rigs right now. We got one report of a 2024 Momentum. I think it was a Momentum, I'm pretty sure.
Really?
Of frame failure. Yeah, one, only one. How long are you going to keep building them this way when you know it's a problem? When you're using recycled steel, they don't care. And it's too big for them to do a recall. We've got rigs going back to 2014. If you know it's got some bad welds on it and you're not saying anything, you're knowingly putting people at risk.
Right.
What is the company trying to hide?
Yeah. Why should they, if they're doing the right thing, why are they asking somebody to sign an NDA? These dealerships are not qualified, nor do they even want to do this because it's warranty work.
I'm Tom.
And I'm Cheri.
And we're EnjoyTheJourney.life.
Well, hey, everyone, we've got Pete West from West on the Move back for an update on the frame failure issue. And it's been a few weeks since we've talked, Pete, and you've just been like taking it easy, right? Not doing much.
So far from the truth. So far from the truth.
I guess, yeah. Catch me up and the viewers on what is going on.
Okay. I think since then I have gone out and created my own Facebook group, and it's called Brand Design RV Major Issues. A lot of the people that were on that previous group that was owned by somebody else, they got ghosted. They're no longer, the site's no longer there.
Right. And We've had comments on the other videos saying, where's that group? It doesn't seem to exist.
Yeah. So one of two things is probably happening there. They were either, they got their buyout or buyback, as they mentioned to me over the phone, you know, voice to voice. We're told to not go any further with this because they're going into a class action lawsuit. Because I know that they were pursuing that possibly. And they did have a law firm involved in it and everything else. So I think it's one of those two things. My guess, though, is it's probably a buyback. And right now, as it stands, I was just told by somebody who looked it up that there is no open class action lawsuit right now against Grand Design. And so with that said, I'm thinking it's more of a buyback situation. So who knows? I mean, it's a guess, to be honest with you.
Right. Yeah. So that was, I mean, I'll say that we did not expect that,
right.
Either both of us. And, I guess the good news is that, again, thanks to you for all the volunteer work that you're doing to advocate for people with this problem. You set up a group and you basically surpassed almost 800 members in this new group. It's very active. You're very responsive, and it's the place to go, I guess, for people that want some answers.
Yes. So we're trying to invite more people to the site. We did have it open public for, I don't know, maybe a week and a half or so. And then I decided, for the protection of the members of the site so they could speak freely, that we make it private. I just felt strongly that maybe we should make it private. And I'm kind of glad we did now, because we're finding a lot of fake accounts. They're out there for sure. And I know we have some Brand and Design people that are on the site as well that maybe got in early. And at one point, I actually invited their director of warranty and customer service, Brad Smith. At one point, I invited him. This was on our third call together. to have somebody in on there so they can see all the customers or the owner's response. And I had not heard, I haven't heard anything back from them yet at this point, whether he wanted to do that or not. For a company that says that they don't really follow social media, and then to tell me in another breath that they have 31 people on their social media team that are just checking their sites only. But yet I know information has gotten back to them from my site. So just like it did on the previous Facebook site. So yeah, that's kind of what's happening with that. And again, like I said, like you said, we're almost up to 800 people now. And every day I'm getting people requesting to join. Because they don't know where else to go or a safe place to go.
Make sure you smash that subscribe button so you catch these full-length interviews with other RV owners that have experienced frame flex and frame failure. Plus, we also have how-tos on many RV topics as well as adventures and RV industry news. So check that out.
Catch up the viewers with what has actually transpired since, I think we
sure
3 weeks ago, that would be my guess, which is a long time in a story like this that just keeps unfolding. Yeah.
Well, I can tell you this, at least every other day, if not almost every day, there's something big that comes out. Now, I know a lot of people heard about the Winnebago Brinkley thing. I don't know if you heard about that.
Only from you.
Okay. So and a lot of people say, what's that got to do with frame failure? And you wouldn't know it unless you look back at the stock market and follow Winnebago there and you find out. I don't want to talk about things that I'm not entirely clear of, but apparently numbers, we've got some people who've looked at that. And the numbers don't jive right. And so this is good opportunity if they were to buy Brinkley. It takes the distraction of Grand Design away from them. You know, it just helps them out, especially if they get it at a good rate. But right now, it's just allegations. I think it's pretty good source, but we'll see what revolves out of that, you know?
So tell me, so we'll say this is a rumor that's not substantiated, but who is the source?
Correct.
And what exactly is the rumor so people know what you're talking about?
The person that came out with this on video, I can't really divulge. You will see it's not a retraction by any means, but on our site, you'll see the video. It's a podcast, and that will explain a little bit more. And I would recommend people go to that, watch it, or listen to it, I should say. It's a podcast. And they can kind of evaluate for themselves if they think this is true or not. I know there's some people that have Brinkley's that are not happy about it. But this industry has a revolving... so in other words, people go from one manufacturer to another, or they buy this company and that company, and then it gets pulled into a bigger company. And the people that work at Brinkley, they were at Grand Design. And now Winnebago's involved. So, and I'm not so much getting into all that right now, but that's kind of going on. And I think a lot of this has to do with what has transpired from Grand Design and the whole frame failure thing. They want to distract away from that. Why not buy a company like Brinkley, right? They're like turning out to be like one of the top brands, even though they're a little bit more pricey. So they're turning out to be one of the top brands that people are looking at. And I mean, I got to admit, I was looking at them too. Can't say I wasn't interested.
Right.
And so is the possibility there? I think the possibility is very much there. It's just a matter of how it pans out. And then, you know, everybody who's saying that's a bunch of this and that, we'll see. Let's just wait and see.
Right. And your contact has a source within Grand Design, from my understanding, right?
Yeah, and I can't say anything. I don't even know who his source is.
Right.
But I get the impression it's somebody who's been in the RV industry for a very long time. Okay. And so he's actually got two sources, but he has taken that video off out of respect for them and just, you know, going to lay low a little bit. And so, yeah. Do I think it's a very good possibility? I do. Who am I? I'm just an RV owner. But when you start hearing things from a lot of different people in the industry and outside the industry, you can kind of put two and two together and realize it equals four.
And I can certainly buy the overall corporate strategy for someone like Winnebago, if they're getting a black eye with one of their brands. Hey, guess what? We've got one of the top quality, you know, new RV companies under our wing now, and yay, focus on that.
Yeah.
And, so I can buy that from a business standpoint.
Exactly. Exactly.
But, I can see why, the Brinkley folks would be, wait a second. We kind of like being, this small upstart company that's doing really well, and we don't need a big corporate giant sticking their fingers in our business.
Well, I don't think it's so much about them. For them, it's profit. That's what it comes down to. Just like all this stuff that's going on with frame failure, this all evolved because people want to line their pockets. It's business. Just like, you know, you have people that bounce from one, again, let me go back to that, that bounce from one company to another. They create new businesses out there. And there's kind of a long history in Indiana for that. So you see all the different smaller companies that are owned by Thor and Winnebago, and I think one's called Rev Group or something, and some others out there, but they're owned by much bigger, larger companies. And Thor, I believe, is the biggest one that there is out there. This is what they do. So it's not about taking care of the customer and the family and all that line of BS, plain and simple. I think we had said something once before, family doesn't do that to each other, at least not the ones that get along. And right. when you see this type of thing happening to people, you start questioning, do they really care about me? No, they don't. I hate to say it, but they don't. They may put on fun parties and the CEO of Grand Design or somebody may wave and give all the accolades and all that, you know, get all the accolades from people. But when it comes down to it, they won't come out, like in this case, Don Clark, come out and publicly admit that they've got an issue. They're going to address it. And they're going to actually stand by the do the right thing tag that they keep putting on their website. Do the right thing. Everybody seems to put that on there in the RV business, but yet they don't do the right thing.
RV News is brought to you by HomeFi Internet and the brand new Titan Router. 18 months ago, we dumped Starlink Internet for a cheaper solution for RV Internet. We went with HomeFi, and for the last year, we've been enjoying fast speeds and a cheaper RV Internet. And just look at what some of our other viewers have said about HomeFi Internet. This will connect to whichever network is the fastest in your area, right down to the exact sector that has the fastest speeds. It's like using the fast lane on a highway. And let's face it, we want high-speed internet when we are camping, whether you are full-time or part-time. After an adventure, you're gonna want to kick back, watch a movie, maybe catch the game, or if you have kids, maybe they wanna do some gaming or watch their own TikTok video. Not everybody wants to spend $600 plus $150 a month for Starlink Internet. Or if you're making a quick stop and you don't want to have to haul out the Starlink antenna, this is all included. The antenna is all included inside of this. You plug it in and it just goes. It arrives to you already activated. And even if you want to keep Starlink, everybody knows you should have backup to your internet in case it's stormy or you're in a wooded campsite and you can't receive your Starlink. This is a great backup for both RV internet and even home internet. The Titan router will work wherever you can get at least one major cell phone signal. So how much is it? The Titan router is cheap. It's $20. There are no credit checks, no contracts. There's a free trial to sign up, and you can cancel at any time that you want to. And all of this starts for as low as $80 per month. But it gets better than that because I've got an exclusive coupon code that I'll put down here that you can save 20% off on your first month. Just scan this QR code and it will take you right to the ordering page, and this can get sent right to your campsite. Or use the link in the description to get yours before your next camping trip.
So is in the time that's gone by, and Grand Design came out with their statement on their website that this is affecting some models' contact customer service. Since then, are they more responsive? Is it the same? Is it worse? What's going on?
So my source that I send people to for Grand Design, she's been outstanding. Again, we all, you know, we talked about her before. She's been outstanding. She's taken and she's still accepting people that I'm sending her way to look at. Then the issue of reimbursement. In other words, making people whole. If Grand Design goes to pick up somebody's RV from, say, Iowa, I'm using that as an actual example. So they have to pay transport from there back to Grand Design and then eventually back to those owners. So how much does that cost? Would you think that costs more than a hotel fee for those two sets of travels, you know, to do that, for staying someplace for 2 or 3 weeks while your rig is getting worked on an elk cart? You have to ask yourself, why wouldn't they cover the cost of the hotel? And so
I did notice that on the Facebook group that did you have some phone calls this morning about that?
Oh yes, I did. So this morning I did have a phone call with my the point of contact that we know about, and then also the director of consumer affairs. That's Mel Williams. Some people may know that name from somebody else's video that bought a reflection. We had a nice conversation, and they thought certain things were in place that were not in place. He even tested it over the phone with me, and that was a new number for people to call if they have frame failure. He tested it with me on the phone. It didn't quite work the way it was supposed to. So they were going to work on that. And I'm like, okay, how new was this number? Was it even tested or anything else? So you have now the director of consumer affairs trying to call it, and it didn't quite work the way it's supposed to. So yes, they do say, and I've got a follow-up email that I sent out this morning to them. We'll see what happens with better contact information and what they're going to do. Right now, as it stands, Tom, some of these people are being sent to dealerships, not just for the diagnosis, you know, the measurements and all that you did, but also they're sending them there for repairs. These dealerships are not qualified, nor do they even want to do this because it's warranty work, but they are not qualified to do the repairs. I've got somebody who called me last night. He just came back from New Orleans. He happened to be at the same RV park where there is a Grand Design rally going on for the eclipse right now. But he called me last night about 8:30 saying that he's got another crack in his frame. And you could see it. Where the down by the window where it's just running right down there. And he thought this thing was fixed. Well, it wasn't. And so now the good thing is there's an SRT team that happens to be there. So they are taking his rig over to a dealership across the road there, and they're going to try to fix it for him to get it roadworthy enough. But at some point, he's probably going to have to turn it into Grand Design to be done properly. And the only place that I really strongly feel, and I told this to Mel, is that they have to be the ones to fix it, not a dealership, you know, and stop sending people to dealerships. The customer service folks, some of them are still doing this. I think they're still giving people the runaround. Not all of them. There's some good ones up there, I'm sure, but they're still giving people the runaround. That's a big problem. That's a really big problem.
Right. And I want to back up a little bit and back to the reimbursing for a hotel or maybe travel expenses that this is not a new thing or an unusual thing for them to pay for the hotel, is it?
Well, apparently it is, because they say, Mel himself told me, according to their warranty, lodging is not included. No reimbursement for lodging is included in that. And I find that interesting, because this isn't a regular warranty. This is a factory. And I said this to him. This is a manufacturer's defect. Well, it's not really a manufacturer's defect. Yes, it is. When three insurance companies tell people that that's exactly what this is, and that they can't cover their through their insurance, that's exactly what this is. It is a factory defect, and they won't own up to it still. Now, look, this is not all on Grand Design when I say this. This is on Lippert. This is on Winnebago, for sure. And Winnebago's been silent. They've been really silent in this whole ordeal. And they still have the same CEO at Grand Design right now, who should be removed from that position. He will not come out and talk about, you know, what's going on with Grand Design and how they want to fix it for the customer. They don't care. And it's too big for them to do a recall. We've got rigs going back to 2014. I just spoke to a lady today. Yes, I'm on the phone a lot. but I just spoke to a lady today who's got a 2014. And luckily, her husband is very mechanically inclined. He did a lot of the repairs on their 2014 frame failure again. But it is an older one, so I'll give them that. I'll give Grand Design that. But I do have a problem with the hotel reimbursement thing. Everybody should be covered.
Well, I'm saying it's not unusual, because I saw at least one comment of somebody that said they were reimbursed for the hotel.
Yes.
And I just know from the industry in general and talking to other people that is something that gets done, because it is such a large expense, and to have to stop traveling, go back to Indiana for multiple weeks. Indiana isn't on most RVers' travel plans unless it's for work.
That's true. It really is a financial burden on everybody. Because remember, too, we got to travel to Elkhart to get this taken care of. So, yeah, as far as the reimbursement, a lot of people would think that that would be covered, and it should be covered in this particular case, especially. Now, I will say, we had our hotel covered. I did use my military discount, too, at the time. When we stayed there for just regular warranty work. But we were only there for like 5-6 days. Here, we're going to be here 3, maybe 4 weeks at our expense. And I'm not, when I approached Mel with this, this whole reimbursement thing, it wasn't with the approach to take care of us, because we'll take care of ourselves. But there are people that's a serious expense. And so we want to make sure everybody else out there is taken care of, and everybody's being treated equally, fairly, because it is hard, especially if you're full time. As you know, as we know, it's difficult when you're full time, you know?
Right. I mean, a lot of people are doing this on a shoestring budget, and they don't exactly have a couple thousand dollars lying around for an extra expense.
Tom, I keep wanting to say that I'm hopeful that they're going to figure this out. But like my wife tells me, they're spitballing right now. They're hoping something will stick. It feels like they don't really have a plan, or it's or either that or it's just not well organized. They should have been working on this from day one when they started seeing this. But here's the problem again. This has been happening back to at least 2014, and it's happening on new rigs right now. We got one report of a 2024 momentum. I think it was a momentum, I'm pretty sure.
Really?
Of frame failure. Yeah, only one. Wow. How long are you going to keep building them this way? How long are you going to keep building them this way when you know it's a problem? When you know you're using recycled steel, I should say Lippert is using recycled steel. The welds are bad to begin with. They're not built for what Grand Design is turning these things into. They're just under-engineered. The tube steel is thin compared to what it should be. And we've got some engineers, as you know, on the site on the Facebook site say the same thing, that these things are under-engineered. When you put two axles on a 44-foot solitude with a kitchen in a cargo area in the back, there's a problem with that. They should be putting a third axle on that.
Right. And to bring up Brinkley again as an example, yep. I have seen other people talk about that Brinkley also uses Lippert frames, and Brinkley yes. is not having frame flex issues that I am aware of. And my right. understanding is because Brinkley has actually ordered heavier duty frames from yes. Lippert. So that's
my understanding.
That's on the manufacturer, like Grand Design, to say, we are going to pay more money for a better quality frame so we don't right. have these issues. And that's been what we think is basically, again, came down to money.
To money.
Yep. Go cheaper on the frame. You know, the momentum looks big and beautiful and huge. It looks very well built from the outside.
It does.
But yeah. the inside, the structure matters. The foundation yeah. matters.
What I keep wondering, I keep forgetting to check into this. The new frame that Lippert came out with, I won't say this site because I just don't want to acknowledge that site any longer. But they did an interview, or he did an interview with Lippert on this new frame. And I am curious, and you tell me, Tom, if you think maybe I'm barking up the wrong tree. I'm curious if that was actually the Brinkley frame. And so if that's the same one where it's built stronger, better steel. Yeah, I kind of wonder if that was Brinkley who initiated that with Lippert. So, yeah, I guess time will tell. But part of that problem, too, is like Grand Design is a good example where in other companies, if they're RV manufacturers or assemblers, I should call them, because that's what they do is they assemble. They don't, other than Lippert, they're the only ones that manufacture stuff, really. But the other RV assemblers, they're ordering these frames and they're accepting them as is. If you know it's got some bad welds on it and you're not saying anything, you're knowingly putting people at risk who own these things, who travel with these things, you know, no integrity at all. And so, yeah, that's a real problem. So, and Tom, I want to bounce over to something too that you all may want to know about. So the RVIA, RV Industry Association, one of the things that we discovered that they have is they have a big group of legislators at the federal level, Senate and the House of Representatives, or the Senate and the House of Representatives, that have an RV caucus. So, and this RV caucus is strictly for the RV industry. So lobbying, basically, is what they are. They're lobbyists. And with that said, there's nobody that's representing us as the owners. It almost feels like we need to have a RV owners association to represent us. So I know one of the things, they've got a convention coming up or a conference of some sort in Washington, D.C. in June. And one of those meetings was with the National Highway Transportation or Traffic Safety Administration, sorry. And I kind of wonder about that meeting. Are they going to be addressing all the complaints that have been coming in regarding the, you know, the grand design fifth wheels? Is that coming up at all? So I guess I want everybody to be aware that there is a whole, this RBIA thing, they're not here for the customer at all. They may put the sticker on the side of the rig and it's RBIA certified. That doesn't mean squat, it's a sticker. They need to know that that sticker is not there for them at all. It's just a little badge to say it's RBIA, I don't know, qualified, inspected. No, they're not inspected. So that's another thing that I've learned too in all this research. There's a lot of stuff that's going on right now. It's almost exhausting.
So yeah, it definitely keeps you busy. I can see how you comment on pretty much everybody's post on the group and multiple times. So that again, thank you for what you're doing to help everybody. Do you have, since it's been, you know, 3-4 weeks since we talked last, do you have any sense of how big the problem is yet? How many, as a percentage of all of the grand design units that this is affecting, instead of the, what, half of 1% that the industry thinks it is?
So our site, the Grand Design RV Major Issues Facebook site, we've got a poll on there and we've got a survey. The survey is, they're both just as important, but the survey is the one that we're getting numbers off of. Unfortunately, out of 780 plus people, I've only got 27 people who've responded on the survey, and I really need them to fill this out. If they, if, you know, 88 on the survey, I'm sorry, I said that wrong. Yeah, 88 people on the survey out of 780 plus people, I should say. I thought that was sounded wrong. And we can't get hard numbers until we get more people to respond on that. So almost on a daily basis now, I've been asking people to please fill it out. I think at some point we will get more participation on that. And some people are just looky-loos on the site. There's always going to be looky-loos.
Right.
I can always tell who the most active people are on there. They've been awesome. They've been absolutely awesome. This site would be nothing without them, to be honest with you. So yeah, we're just waiting for more response, but what we're seeing so far, this is the problem. And a number I will add to that, a number of people that have gone to get theirs repaired have had to go a second and even a third time to go back and get it repaired. Yes. And for, again, because of the fact that we don't have everybody responding yet, and we may have some more later down the line, this site is not going away. And I'll say this publicly right here and now, this site is not going away. I am not signing an NDA. If I do anything, I would sign it over to somebody else as the owner. But at this point, no, I don't see me going anywhere anytime soon.
And I guess we should say, and I guess we should talk about this too.
Sure.
This has been a strategy of Grand Design to help make the problem go away,
is
that people that they are, is it, I guess, people with the biggest problems that are being the most vocal about it, either social media or YouTube, are getting offers to buy back their RV if they stop posting and actually take down their posts.
Yes, that is actually happening, and I can verify that is happening. I don't know to what degree, but I know especially like YouTubers who are in a situation and they're told to take all their videos down, you know, as part of this, you know, non-disclosure agreement. Yeah. Why should they, if they're doing the right thing, why are they asking somebody to sign an NDA? If we're all family members, why are they asking us to sign an NDA? I just find it odd that this is happening. I don't even know what to say. My head shakes every time I hear of one.
I think it is, it's a before social media strategy. I think maybe 20, 30 years ago, maybe that would work because
Right.
people, but now there are no secrets. So when just the idea, when you say NDA, you get a negative response. Like,
Right.
what is the company trying to hide? And to
Yeah.
me, they're destroying the goodwill of a happier RV owner that they got their problems taken care of. It would be good if they said, oh yeah, Grand Design bought my RV back and now I'm going to go buy a different one. They go, oh, okay, Grand Design took care of it. Great. But like, oh, Grand Design, I no longer have a Grand Design and I can't talk about it. It's like, I don't know. It seems like it gives the
I
company
know.
a negative image, if you ask me.
It does.
So.
But you know, honestly, I don't think they care. I mean, as many times as I have asked the CEO president, Don Clark, to come forward and just accept it, help the customers and all that kind of stuff, they just don't care. They've got a strategy too. My guess is at some point, Winnebago may let Don Clark go off on a golden parachute and he'll go off to Brinkley or someplace else, or maybe he'll just start hitting the golf course full time. But he's definitely not helping the company right now, nor the people, nor the owners. And I find it shameless. I find it downright shameless. Shameful, I should say. It makes no sense to me. The thought behind trying to hide and secretly let people in and get their RVs fixed secretly. And that's what they're doing through me. Don't get me wrong. I've become kind of a surrogate for them because I want people to get their rigs fixed. And so I'm actually helping them out, you know, whether I mean, I realize it, but I'm not doing it for the intent to help Grand Design out. I'm doing it for the intent to help the owners out because we got some pretty upset people.
Right.
And I mean, I'm talking very upset, like emotionally upset over this.
Well, and you're willing to get on a heated phone call with
Oh,
somebody
yeah.
and demand an answer. And not everybody's willing to, you know, go toe to toe with somebody. And well, like we talked about, part of the purpose of your Facebook group is so people can talk freely. And we know that you know, I'm a member of the you know, the some of the other Grand Design groups, and
Right.
somebody has posted my own videos talking about this issue, and there's a lot of people saying it doesn't exist, you know, or they it's turned into a drinking game. Like, oh, every
Yeah.
time someone says brain flex, you got to take a drink, you know,
Yeah.
and that's still the attitude. That was recent.
is.
So,
It is.
I think that whole the Grand Design cult, you
Yeah.
know, and I don't mean cult in a bad word, you know, you can have a really tight group of people that
Right.
really enjoy what they're doing, but when people stop looking at the facts and will support a company despite staring at the facts to say, well, it must be the user, it must be the RVer that's got the problems, I don't think it's right. I mean,
No.
and people need that safe space to
Right.
express themselves and to not be attacked. And just looking at some of the videos on the site, it
Wow.
is so horrible what people are going through.
Absolutely horrible. Yeah, I've got so many of those too. They're not all quite that bad. Like, we're not that bad with ours yet. And that's because of, oh, by the way, great job on the Gen Y to you. But because I really believe, because of our Gen Y executive pin box and our independent suspension, I really believe that that's helped minimize a lot of this. That's why we don't have it as bad as some other people out there. And when I say bad, we're talking rigs are falling apart in some areas. So I'm seeing so much more of it now, so much more. And even more since we started this Facebook group. I don't have the words.
And, speaking of independent suspension, I was having a conversation when we were getting ours installed, and
Right.
I don't think MoreRide is ready to say this, or they don't have any actual studies or proof of
Right.
this. But my belief, and I'm going to guess that you're going to agree with this, that adding the independent suspension actually helps to strengthen the frame. That when you see what they do underneath to install
Yeah.
that, it is tremendous reinforcement to that
Yeah.
area. And I not an engineer, but
Right.
in knowing the difference in the ride and how it handles on the road and takes those potholes and rough roads, I
Right.
have to think that there is a strengthening of the frame besides a lot less movement, which was the goal in the first place.
Right. Well, listen, I can tell you this. I'm not the guy who normally closes the slide outs. My wife is. But I left out cat litter, or not cat litter, cat food sitting on the counter in a plastic tub. A 400-mile trip, it was still there. It never fell over. So if that doesn't sell anybody, I don't know what does. So yes, I do believe that that helps tremendously. And that's why I encourage people, if you're buying a new RV, and you can put it into the financing, whatever, get independent suspension. I think it was like, for us, it was like $11,000 for three axles. That's three axles. So I don't know, maybe 8,000 for two axles, but it is worth every penny because it's going to save your rig. These things are not built well at all. They're not built for the money we spend on them. And this case here with Grand Design, we know they're not built well. And we're seeing it in the fifth wheel line. You got to do everything you can to firm up your chassis. And that's a good way to do that is independent suspension. And I'm not getting paid by MoreRide, believe me. But it just makes sense.
And what I'll do is, we do have a relationship with MoreRide. I'll put our information
Right.
down below. And if
Good.
you
Good.
mention Enjoy the Journey, you get like $100 worth of free stuff from
All
MoreRide
right.
if you get independent suspension. So I will put that out there. And we are compensated for MoreRide to talk about MoreRide. But we love them.
Good.
We love MoreRide and all of the cool stuff that they come out with. So we're very happy to talk about them when we can. And that, along with the Gen Y, which I don't have that much experience with pin boxes. It's like the third pin box we've had, and I feel like it's the best one out there for this.
You've just bought the best one that you could ever get. Yeah, I do believe that. Let me go back to the MoreRide thing. Wouldn't it be a concept that maybe that Lippert had some competition in building frames and MoreRide did it? Just think about it. Competition, not a monopoly. When you look at a company like Lippert, they're a monopoly. They own all these smaller companies. I found out they own Dometic. I didn't know that. Furion, they own a lot of companies. And for this to be happening with their frames, because it's not just happening with Grand Design, as we both know, it's happening with other manufacturers. It's just the way that Grand Design is handling it compared to other companies. is silent. You know, we use that term deafening silence. And that's why grand design is handling this so bad. So yeah, they're not the only ones with frame failure, but they're the ones with the biggest amount of frame failure for sure.
Just back to the final count of what units are experiencing this, we still don't know. Right. Is it 5%? Is it 10%? Is it 50%? I mean, we don't know. And I guess it's important to say that you may not see any physical symptoms at all, but every unit should be checked, right?
Right. Well, you know, it's funny. Somebody on our, who's an engineer, actually, somebody on our site did a thing, and I wish I had it in front of me, but he said, even if you go by that one half of less than 1%, or, you know, less than half of 1%, if you go by that, he figured out, he did the calculation, and he figured out it still comes out to 1,800 fifth wheels that would have frame failure.
Okay.
Just using their numbers alone. And it's on the site here. I have to dig around to find it. But it came out with, for a year, 1,800 fifth wheels would have this problem. That's still way too high. That's just using their calculation. I think it's probably, as I got from somebody else who's what's the word? Let's just say he's very boisterous. And I think the world of him. I really do. Those that know the honey badger, very colorful in his language. So don't watch him with kids. But you know what? He's pretty smart. He's been in this business for a while. And one of the things he's come up with so far is like 3% at least. Okay. And that's just based off smaller numbers that he has right now. But he's literally putting that stuff out there. Yeah, he's probably pretty damn close to it. I would say at least probably 3% minimum.
Well, and that would be what, six times the industry estimate, if that was true?
I don't even know. I'm not sure what the industry estimate is at this point, because nobody's really come out, at least not that I've heard. I'm sure maybe somebody has said something, but not that I've heard myself. 6%, I mean, that's a fair amount. That's 6% is quite a bit if you look at the people that have to deal with that, especially if you're full time, or you travel around a lot. That's another factor too. If you travel around a lot, that's a big factor in this too. So yeah, it's I don't know. We'll see how this all plays out, but it's not pretty right now. And I'm so curious to see what happens with the whole Winnebago Brinkley thing, if that's really real or not. Right. I'm starting to think it is.
So I guess what's also important to say that the lag bolts are a really big issue, that even if you don't think you have frame flex, you should get this checked, but also check for the lag bolts, because that could affect what, almost every unit built during that time frame.
Yes, we're seeing it a lot. So I have a little insight on that. I'm glad you brought that up, because I would have forgotten. Lag bolts is a big issue. Right now, a lot of the frames are drilled out from Lippert for a half inch. And then you're supposed to put a half inch bolt in there. And what Grand Design has been doing over the years is putting 3/8 inch bolts. And what's happening is they're falling out, they're bending. So now the director of warranty and customer service, Brad Smith, told me that they're now putting all bolts half inch. Every one of the holes are being filled. So what's happening with some people is some of the holes have never had a bolt in them. And you can tell. I know Jared off of All About RVs, I believe is his site. He had 7 holes. He only had 2 bolts out of 7. That were in there.
I watched that video. Yeah.
Yeah, that's a reflect, and that's a Grand Design reflection. So to say that reflections are not part of this is wrong. Now, they may not be as high as the momentums in the solitudes, but they're wrong when they say that reflections aren't part of this, because even we have some from our site where there is brain failure on a reflection, on some reflections. So, yeah, the bolts are a big, big deal. And the problem is, too, is they're not going to hold. A lot of people were finding out that they're not holding. You know, they come loose. So to me, it sounds like it was a poor design to begin with, as far as holding the walls up, structure up to the frame.
Yeah, it's something that to have taken, have a look at, you know, by a tech. And like we're at that point right now where we have the authorization to take it in. We had to get a little bit of work from a mobile tech to get our RV even worthy for the road. But trying to decide, take it to a grand design dealer or take it to an independent dealer to look at it. And so that's where I'm trying to decide.
Okay, so Tom, I'm going to recommend it to you. Don't take it to an independent. Make this grand design fix it. Make them aware that they have a problem with your rig and they'll cover it, because they are now covering second and third owners. At least that's what they're telling people.
Right.
They're literally telling people that. I would really recommend just taking it up to Elkhart, get an appointment date, and you know who to call.
Right.
I won't say it all over the air, but you know who to call. First email. Get it documented. And then if somebody calls you back, we know who we're talking about here. Then you guys can schedule over the phone what needs to be fixed and, you know, when's a good time to come up and that type of thing. But this way you have it documented. But I would definitely let Grand Design fix it. They should be given the opportunity to fix it and fix it correctly. Now, if it doesn't get fixed correctly and it happens again, guess what? Now it's on the manufacturer. And you're still covered under warranty. Get that extended 1 year warranty on that too, on their repair. And don't sign an NDA.
Right.
So they're really trying to get YouTubers to sign NDAs. And typically that's been for buybacks for the most part, not so much with the repairs. And give them ample opportunity. Don't get me wrong. I want to work with them to help everybody get fixed. But I'm still going to hold them accountable. As a company as a whole, these were under-engineered. And I'm no engineer, but I've heard this from engineers. So they need to be held accountable, you know, for this manufacturing defect.
Right. And there are so many people with engineering knowledge, and with the fact that so many have recorded what it looks like when they take off the covering and inspect the frame, what they're seeing, the breaks and the bad welds, and a lot of opinions on how bad these frames are. And what we'll do, we'll put Grand Design's contact information as well as Lippert as well in the comments, so you can at least, you know, email them or call them to get help, get pointed in the right direction.
Tell you one quick story. A customer, this actually happened, was told that something wouldn't be covered because Lippert won't cover it. He was told this by a Grand Design person, a customer service person, said that Lippert won't cover this. So the owner called Lippert and said, "Hey, I was told that this wouldn't be covered by you guys because Grand Design told me that." And they were like, "We don't even see you in the system as far as any kind of complaints or anything else. So we're not sure what you're talking about." So he went back to the Grand Design rep and they said, "Well, that's not what we told you." "Well, that's exactly what you told him. You told him that Lippert turned down the warranty claim." And so this is another big problem with customer service. So this is, beware of this. Be very aware of this.
What is the standard warranty on the frame from Lippert?
I don't know what the warranty for through Lippert is. I know Grand Design tells it's like a 3-year structural
Okay.
Warranty, and that's just, you know, structural stuff. The frame would be covered under that, obviously. But what I find interesting, though, is it is the manufacturer, the assemblers, who are actually the ones taking them apart and repairing them and everything else. So I don't know whether they have grand design people there at the different RV assemblers or manufacturers, as some people want to call them, or if it's just grand design in this case, fixing theirs and, you know, Keystone fixing theirs and that type of thing. So I don't know if there's a Lippert representative there on site when these things are being fixed. I do know that they don't let people see them before they close them up. Guess who's going to see his? Who's absolutely going to see his? Because I'm going to have them take the nose right back off again, because I want to see the repairs that were done. I just want a basic understanding that it was repaired correctly. And I will wake up at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning. I do that now.
Yeah, you're due to take your momentum back.
Yes,
really soon, right?
Yeah, we're taking it back we have to turn it in April 22nd. We're going to go a week early and we're going to take everything out so they have room to work on everything. And so we're going to be up there for that and kind of see what happens, see how it goes.
Okay. Well, we will have to talk to you again afterward, Pete, to get an update on, you know, how they took care of everything, and to hear that you haven't signed an NDA, right?
Never. I like my integrity is intact. I'll say that much. My integrity is intact and I'm keeping it that way. And like I said, again, Tom, I'm doing this for everybody else out there because it's not right what's happening. And, you know, I don't mind having a big mouth and sticking my neck out, you know, to help other people. So, and we're making progress, to be honest with you. We're making progress. We got a number of people that are getting scheduled. They're in there getting repaired right now as we speak. I mean, we are making progress. So I feel pretty good about that.
Well, awesome. Well, thank you again, Pete, for all the work that you've been doing. Pete West, West's on the Move. We'll put links to your social media down below as well and any other helpful links. We have a whole blog post with some helpful information, different contact, our other videos that we've done about this as well. So, well, thank you so much again, Pete, for your time. And we will talk to you again soon to find out what's going on.
All right. Well, thanks, Tom. I appreciate the interview.